Уважаемые коллеги, разрешите представить вашему вниманию нашего гостя, профессора Франциско Эстео из онкологического центра МД Андерсон. Это один из ведущих онкологических центров мира. Я хочу сказать, что помимо клинической работы, ведения пациентов, профессор Эстео заведует лабораторией, в которой изучаются вопросы резистентности к различным таргетным препаратам, циркулирующие опухолевые маркеры, генетические изменения при раке. И хочу отметить, что при непосредственном участии профессора Эстео в клинику вошли такие препараты, как трастузумаб, лупотинип, вералимус, пертузумаб. Тема сегодняшней лекции – таргетная терапия при раке молочной железы.
Introduction first, and then talk about some of the clinical trials that have been done mostly in the HER2-positive breast cancer, but also I'll touch at the end. I'll talk a little bit about the role of the PI3 kinase pathway, which is very important in breast cancer. So, why are biomarkers important in breast cancer? Well, we don't treat all patients the same way. So we know cancer is a genetic disease. We know each patient's tumor is unique. And also the cancer treatments are becoming very sophisticated, and we need to have a better understanding of tumor biology. So we know cancer is a genetic disease, so what do we understand about the molecular events that lead to the formation and progression of a malignant tumor? This is a very important question. What do we need to understand from each patient to treat the patient the best way, now and in the future? And then, as we develop biomarkers, we need to know how to use them in the clinic, not only in the basic research laboratories. So I'll try to touch a little bit on all these areas during my talk. So breast cancer, like many solid tumors, evolves sometimes from a typical hyperplasia to ductal carcinoma in situ to invasive cancer. But sometimes it doesn't go through this process. It goes from, we don't know, a normal cell to a cancer cell without going through all these steps. What we know is that there are many changes in the DNA, the RNA, and the protein that lead to the hallmarks of cancer. The hallmarks of cancer include cellular proliferation through independent growth signaling. Cells learn how to avoid apoptosis or programmed cell death. It's developed ways to become insensitive to anti-growth signals, they survive, they develop blood vessels, and they replicate limit without any limit in brain metastasize. So all of these are very important things we've learned over the years, but how this applies to a specific patient is quite complex. One of the most important pathways, well, perhaps the two most important pathways, I think, in breast cancer and many solid tumors are the PI3 kinase pathway and the MAP kinase pathway. So growth factor receptors like EGF receptor, HER2, IGF receptor, and many of these tyrosine kinase receptors activate both signaling pathways. The PI3 kinase pathway, PI3 kinase activates AKT, AKT activates mTOR, and so on, and that leads to cell proliferation. The PI3 kinase is very important in cell survival in general, very important in glucose metabolism for normal cells as well. P10 is the natural brake of this pathway. It's a phosphatase that removes phosphate from this cascade, So it blocks PI3 kinase directly, and I'll talk about this a little bit more. The MAP kinase pathway, the RAS, RAF, MEK, ERK, MAP kinase pathway, is very important for cell proliferation. So we have two major pathways, cell survival and cell proliferation, and these are activated in many types of cancer through growth factor receptor activation like HER2, or cross-signaling, cross-talk with other receptors like the estrogen receptor. Sometimes the brakes are lost, like the P10 could be lost, and that activates the pathway, and there may be mutations. So we'll talk about this in a little bit more detail, because these become important targets for the development of therapeutics. 100 years ago, breast cancer was one disease. Everybody talked about breast cancer, even 50 years ago, even not too long ago. In the 1970s, 1980s, there was knowledge about the hormone receptors, positive and negative. Later, the HER2 positive, HER2 was identified as an important predictive marker of response to treatment. Monoclonal antibodies like trastuzumab or Herceptin were developed, and then now we classified patients HER2 positive and negative. Microarray technology, first published in 2000 in the journal Nature by Chuck Theroux and colleagues, identified four major types, luminal A and luminal B, which are estrogen receptor positive breast cancer, mostly HER2, and then basal light, which is basically the triple negative most of the time. And now we have other markers like the FGF receptor, PI3 kinase mutations in the ER-positive tumors, and so on. So we are becoming to have shorter and smaller numbers of patients. And in the future, who knows, we may find patients, as I will show you at the end, breast cancer is very heterogeneous. So you're going to have mutations in a very small number of patients. And how to deal with that is a big challenge as we develop targeted therapies. If we think about breast cancer in these four major types, luminal A, luminal B, which are more like luminal A is the most estrogen receptor responsive to endocrine therapy, very sensitive tumors. Luminal B tend to have higher proliferation. They do not respond as well to endocrine therapy, even though they are estrogen receptor positive. Then you have the HER2 positives, which could be ER positive or ER negative. And the basal tumors, again, many of them are triple negative, ER, PR, HER2 negative. So we go from low proliferation, high sensitivity to endocrine therapy, to more proliferative tumors and less sensitivity to endocrine therapy. So as we analyze breast cancers, if you take a breast cancer, put it in one of these microarrays with 20,000 genes, the first in the hierarchical clustering analysis, the first separation always comes down to estrogen receptor positive or negative. It's very consistent, so that's very important. But not all of them respond to endocrine therapy. So again, and the HER2 is a very specific subtype that we'll talk about this year. So when we think about targeted therapies or biomarkers, it's very important to differentiate prognostic markers from predictive markers. So prognostic markers are going to tell us what's the natural history of the disease without any treatment. So we get, you know, every patient, most patients get actually systemic therapy nowadays, but so prognostic markers in the absence of therapy to me are not so useful, but still we can decide if the patient is going to have good prognosis, bad prognosis, and so on, to select adjuvant systemic therapy or not, adjuvant chemotherapy. The predictive markers are more important. The estrogen receptor positive, progesterone receptor positive patients tend to get endocrine therapy, HER2 positives, trastuzumab, lapatinib, and so on, and triple negatives, as of today, get chemotherapy. So the HER2 is an interesting story, so I want to spend some time on this because it's probably the most important, best example of targeted therapy in breast cancer. So the HER2, or the epidermal growth factor receptor 2, some member of these tyrosine kinase receptors, EGF receptor or 2, 3, and 4, which basically are, again, tyrosine kinases, they signal after they heterodimerize. They dimerize with each other, and they signal through the PI3 kinase and the MAP kinase pathway. And there are a number of targeted therapies that have been developed over the last few years. In the United States, the ones that are approved by the FDA to treat patients are trastuzumab, pertuzumab, and lapatinib. I'll talk a little bit about trastuzumab and pertuzumab, and I'll show you some of the new information about trastuzumab DM1, which is a new construct, the antibody and chemotherapy together. I'll talk a little bit about lapatinib. And then there's other signaling pathway inhibitors, so like everolimonicin, mTOR inhibitors, PI3 kinase inhibitors. And today I will not discuss the vaccines or immunotherapy approaches, but those are also very interesting, particularly for HER2. There are some vaccines that appear to have some efficacy. So breast cancer, HER2-positive breast cancer, when it was first published, it was associated with a poor prognosis. But now, because of all these treatments, like the trastuzumab-based therapy, for example, have made the prognosis of these patients is actually the best of all of the breast cancer. In the adjuvant setting, the patients with early stage, they have an excellent prognosis because of all this chemotherapy and trastuzumab-based therapies. And this is data actually from the metastatic setting, from the MD Anderson Cancer Center, retrospective analysis of the patients with HER2-positive disease treated without Herceptin, the HER2 positives treated with Herceptin, and so on. So you have a better prognosis if patients are treated with Herceptin, even if they are better than the HER2 negative. And in the adjuvant setting, there were five clinical trials, four of them very important trials that led to the FDA approval and the European EMA approval of trastuzumab in the adjuvant setting. In these trials, more than 10,000 patients, 12,000 patients were randomized to trastuzumab versus not trastuzumab in the adjuvant setting, and all of them showed significant improvements in disease-free survival and overall survival for the patients who received trastuzumab in the adjuvant setting for early-stage breast cancer. So for a patient with stage 1 and stage 2, they have HER2 gene amplification. Those patients, at least in the United States, are always treated with trastuzumab for 1 year. The most recent studies published or presented at European meetings show that the 1 year is probably the best duration of treatment so far. 2 years was not better than 1 year, and 6 months was not as good as 1 year. So it seems that for now, the 1 year of trastuzumab is the standard of care for patients with early stage breast cancer. So how do we identify these patients? Every patient who's diagnosed with breast cancer today is tested for estrogen receptor, for progesterone receptor, and for HER2. And there are some issues as to how you score these tumors in the pathology department. So we have immunohistochemistry eligible for treatment with trastuzumab. Using FISH, or fluorescence in situ hybridization, where you look at the gene code, the protein with immunohistochemistry. Also, and the College of Pathologists have changed and chromosome 17 copy number, if it was 2 or more, that was positive. Now they make this new guideline that it should be more than 2.2, less than 1.8, the ratio, then it was negative, and in between was indeterminate. Well, all the trastuzumab, all the Herceptin clinical trials were not done using these guidelines. If the ratio was 2 of the HER2 over chromosome 17, that was a positive HER2 test. Now it's a little bit higher. So This is a paper published by Edith Perez and one of the cooperative groups in the US, where they applied this type of guidelines to one of the trastuzumab adjuvant trials, one of the largest adjuvant trials, randomized trials with chemotherapy, AC followed by taxol chemotherapy, with or without trastuzumab. And if so, for those clinical trials, as I said, the criteria were different. They had the gene amplification if there was more than two, and the immunohistochemistry had to be 10% of the cells instead of 30% of the cells. And if you apply these new criteria to this clinical trial, you would miss patients who would actually benefit from trastuzumab. So the recommendation is to use the FDA-approved criteria if you're going to use the test to select the treatment. So if a patient has a HER2 ratio of HER2 over chromosome 17 of 2, that patient should be eligible for trastuzumab based on the FDA approval of this drug. That's what we use in our clinic. So this has been a good improvement in the last few years. The development of trastuzumab basically changed the natural history of HER2-positive breast cancer, but still, some patients are not cured. If patients with breast cancer get the best surgery, radiation therapy, endocrine therapy, trastuzumab, about 15 to 20% of patients still develop metastases. So meaning the treatment, all the treatments we have were not available or not helpful for this patient. And then in the metastatic setting, when patients have metastases, Herceptin and this type of therapies improve the survival of these patients, overall survival, which is very good, but patients end up dying of the disease anyway. So we need to do more to understand this disease and be able to cure these patients. That's our goal, not just improve survival, but get rid of these, all these cancer cells if we can. So we and others have looked at many biomarkers to try to identify what's causing this resistance to treatment. We looked at, as I said, many markers. Some of them are listed on this slide. IGF-1 receptor, PI3 kinase mutations, P10 loss, P53, CMYK, P95. The problem is none of them have been validated in prospective clinical trials. So we do not use any of these markers to exclude patients from trastuzumab-based therapy at the moment, because we don't really know if it's going to work in real time in the clinic. So in terms of treatment to overcome resistance, there are a number of approaches. One is, of course, lapatinib, which is approved for treatment. It's a tyrosine kinase inhibitor of the EGF receptor and HER2 of both proteins. There's these antibodies I'll talk about a little bit, pertuzumab, T-DM1, there's mTOR inhibitors and so on. So I'm going to discuss a little bit briefly some of these new treatments. Lapatinib is interesting in that it's very effective in the laboratory, blocking the HER2 pathway, blocking phosphorylation of HER2 and EGF receptor. And it was approved in patients who had progressed after trastuzumab based therapy in the metastatic setting. But now we have better treatments, as I will show you at the end of my talk. In the neoadjuvant setting, what's been shown is that if you combine trastuzumab with lapatinib, you get a higher efficacy in the neoadjuvant setting, higher pathological complete responses when you combine trastuzumab and lapatinib versus one or the other by themselves with taxol chemotherapy. So we did a study, lapatinib was approved after trastuzumab failure in the metastatic setting. So we did a we did a clinical trial combining trastuzumab, lapatinib, and taxol in the frontline setting at the beginning, the first setting of metastatic HER2-positive breast cancer. So these were stage 4 metastatic breast cancers, HER2-positive by FISH or immunohistochemistry, no prior treatment for metastatic disease, and no prior trastuzumab unless it was more than a year before. And we basically had to treat the patients in different ways because the combination was actually quite toxic. We saw a lot of toxicity when we combined the trastuzumab, lapatinib, and Taxol at full doses, so we had to decrease the dose. So this became more of a phase one type of study. The treatment was very effective, 76%, 64, 65, 70% response rate is very good, a very effective therapy, but the problem was the toxicity. So there was a lot of diarrhea, 62% of grade 3 diarrhea is quite significant. Dropping the doses of these drugs, even we go down to 25%, which is still significant. So what we found was an interaction, a pharmacokinetic interaction between lapatinib and Taxol, and in this group of with Herceptin as well. So it increased the area under the curve, the exposure of both lapatinib and Taxol when you combine them together, probably leading to this excessive toxicity, mostly diarrhea. So again, others in Europe have shown that you can do it, but we found it quite difficult in our patients. So another approach is to use this type of therapies combined without chemotherapy. So this was a study published in the Journal of Clinical Oncology a couple of months ago that basically patients who have received multiple treatments with trastuzumab and progressed in the metastatic setting were treated with trastuzumab and lapatinib compared with lapatinib alone, and the ones who received the combination, their survival was much better. This is the overall survival, which is very unusual to see overall survival after so many treatments. So there may be a role for lapatinib at the later stages of the treatment. Perhaps at the early stage, if the randomized trials are positive, but in between, it's unclear how we're going to use this drug. So I'd like to say a few words about the PI3 kinase, AKT, mTOR pathway, because this is some of the targeted therapies are being developed against this pathway. So you have all these receptors, like HER2 or could be other receptors, PI3 kinase, AKT, mTOR, the same pathway we talked about before. And then we published a few years ago, that if the P10 here is lost, the break in the system is lost, then there is hyperactivation of the PI3 kinase pathway, and that leads to resistance to trastuzumab. Now, in the adjuvant setting, in patients with early stage breast cancer, the group from the NCCTG, big cooperative group in the United States, they looked at the primary tumors and see if the P10 loss would correlate with the response to the survival of these patients in the adjuvant setting, and they didn't see any difference. So we may be wrong, or it may be that what you see in the primary tumor and what you see in the metastatic setting are two different things. In fact, I don't have a slide, but if you look at the last issue of Clinical Cancer Research, there was a publication from the group at Memorial Sloan Kettering in New York where they actually did a biopsy of patients with metastatic breast cancer after receiving trastuzumab in the adjuvant setting, and they found a significant number of patients with P10 loss or PI3 kinase mutations, confirming all the studies we had done at MD Anderson. So it's an interesting story that perhaps this is a real thing, but again, we are not using these markers right now to decide whether to treat with Herceptin or not, but it may be a way to select patients for targeted therapies. There are many inhibitors, many new treatments being tested in this pathway. Some of them are shown here. They go from pure PI3 kinase inhibitors to pure AKT inhibitors to ones that can block both of them, and so on. So we did a clinical trial published a few months last year, a clinical trial where we combined trastuzumab with everolimus, which is an mTOR inhibitor, in patients who had progressed after trastuzumab failure. We did not select the patients by P10 or PI3 kinase for the study. It was just HER2 positive patients who had developed progressive disease on trastuzumab, and we combined it with the everolimus with the idea that blocking trastuzumab at the top, and then with the mTOR inhibitor, we could block the pathway more efficiently. And these patients did not receive chemotherapy with this treatment, so it was only the trastuzumab and everolimus. And we saw about a few patients had objective responses, but about 34%, a third of the patients, had a stable disease for 6 months or longer, or a partial response. So that's what we would consider clinical benefit in the metastatic setting. So this is an example of a patient who had lung metastases, as you can see here, who responded nicely to this treatment with trastuzumab and everolimus. This is another patient who had stable disease in this liver metastases. Now, in this study, we did PET scans in some patients to see if we could predict the response to treatment better, because just measuring the size of the tumor sometimes is not the best thing to do with these targeted therapies without chemotherapy. So in this case, we saw no response by a CT scan, but you see a response by PET scan, and this patient was stable with this disease for approximately 1 year or so. So there may be better ways to assess response to treatment than CT scans, but that's what we use in our standard clinical trials. Another is an ongoing phase 3 study that is randomizing patients to trastuzumab and everolimus with vinorelbine versus trastuzumab, vinorelbine, and placebo. So it's a randomized trial called Bolero 3 that's ongoing at the moment. Another targeted therapy is pertuzumab. So we know about trastuzumab for many years, the HER2 antibody, and pertuzumab is another antibody shown here that binds HER2 but to a different epitope, different part of HER2. So the HER2 receptor actually has four domains. So the outside of the receptor has four parts of it, four domains. Trastuzumab is directed against one of them, domain number four, and pertuzumab is directed against domain number two. Now the important part about this, this part of the HER2 receptor is that is where they dimerize with other receptors. So HER2 has to bind to HER3 or the EGF receptor, and it does it through this dimerization part of the protein, and pertuzumab was an antibody that blocks this dimerization between HER2 and HER3. So a few years ago, we were conducting this type of studies about 10 years ago in my laboratory, and we found that when you combine both antibodies, trastuzumab and pertuzumab, we saw an increase in apoptosis in cell lines in the laboratory, growing in plastic, basically, in the lab, as you can see here by two different methods, an XIN5 part cleavage. We saw a significant induction of apoptosis. So with trastuzumab, you don't see much of an apoptosis in vitro. It's very effective in patients, but in the laboratory, you don't see that much. So we saw this, we found it was an interesting finding. And a few years later, a group in Europe published a similar study in animal models, and then this was taken to the clinic in clinical trials, combining these receptors. There were some responses in patients who were progressing on trastuzumab and then treated with trastuzumab and pertuzumab. And recently, the study was published, the randomized phase 3 study that randomized patients with metastatic breast cancer, frontline setting, to docetaxel trastuzumab and placebo, or docetaxel trastuzumab and pertuzumab. And there was a significant improvement in time to progression. Again, it's not the cure of this disease, but it's a improvement over the previous treatment. So the FDA in the United States has approved pertuzumab because of this clinical trial to be used in patients with frontline HER2-positive breast cancer. Another therapy that is in development that is likely to be approved very soon because it's getting very good results is trastuzumab DM1. It's a construct between the antibody and chemotherapy together. And this light shows you a breast cancer cell. This is immunofluorescence, and this is staining for HER2. So you see, HER2 is overexpressed in the cell membrane. Usually when the tumor is 3+ positive gene amplified, you see complete staining of the membrane, which is one of the definitions of the 3+ immunohistochemistry staining. And the other aspect of HER2 that is interesting is that the receptor gets internalized all the time. So the receptor is being recycled all the time. It goes in and out. So you have an antibody that binds the cell surface, that it gets internalized. That's a good target for this development of this target, the antibody drug conjugates. So T-DM1 is an interesting idea. Is this trastuzumab monoclonal antibody therapy Herceptin bound to this chemical called DM1? It's a very potent chemotherapy. It binds the receptor the same way, because it's trastuzumab is basically the antibody currently. It's internalized, as shown in this cartoon, and then the lysosomes, the toxin is released, and it kills the cancer cell. So this type of idea of combining an antibody with chemotherapy is an old idea, it's not new. 15, 20 years ago they were doing this type of research, but at that time these constructs were very toxic. So when I was doing my training in Washington DC at the NIH, they were doing this type of trials, and patients developed liver failure, kidney failure was a big problem. The main thing with this therapy that is now called trastuzumab DM1, they were able to find the right linker, so the toxin is not released in the liver or somewhere else, causing all this damage. So in the phase one clinical trials, which were very important, after many years of studies in animal models, including non-human primates, they showed that it was safe. It wasn't very toxic. The main side effect actually was thrombocytopenia, low platelets, which is very unusual actually. Unexpected toxicity, because HER2 is an epithelial marker, is not overexpressed in platelets. So why this medication causes low platelets is not clear. But that was seen in the phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3. It always happens with this type of therapy. So this is the first phase 3 study, randomized trial, that was published recently. And that was a study that in patients who were progressing after trastuzumab and chemotherapy, the standard treatment was capecitabine and lapatinib, and they compared this to the T-DM1 to this treatment, and there was a significant improvement in time to progression and also improvement in overall survival. So this was published a few weeks ago in the New England Journal of Medicine. It's not approved by the FDA, but it will be approved very soon because of this. It's not only efficacious that improves over the standard of before that was capecitabine and lapatinib, but also it's not only more effective, but it's actually less toxic. Patients do not lose their hair. They have fatigue and some other issues, but it's relatively well tolerated, much better than most chemotherapies. And so it has both more efficacy and lower toxicity. So another, there's a very large phase 3 study in the frontline setting that is finished, but it has not been published yet, that randomized patients to standard Herceptin and taxane therapy compared with T-DM1 alone and compared to T-DM1 plus pertuzumab. So that is a study with that recruited 1,000 patients. It's called Marianne study and is not published yet. Now, to end, I'd like to just give you a brief review of where we are in terms of other targets. So breast cancer is, as we discussed at the beginning, is very heterogeneous. You have the estrogen receptor, the progesterone receptor, the HER2, but there is 20,000 other genes. So this is a very important publication. If you have some time and you're interested in breast cancer, genomics, this is the most important study published in many, many years. It's published in Nature, is the results of the TCGA, the Cancer Genome Atlas for Breast Cancer, as you know, they're doing this for every type of cancer. And they sequenced in all ways you can think of, the gene sequence, the RNA expression, protein levels, RNA, DNA, everything, in about 800 patients. In some other, in some of the tests, they only did it with about 500 patients, but this is the most comprehensive analysis of breast cancer at very high level. And one of the things that, came up, if we separate, as we know, let's say, ER-positive versus ER-negative breast cancer, these are some of the genes on the left that have been associated with cancer at some point. If you think about targeted therapies, if you think about what are the targets, the genes involved in breast cancer, these are some of the most important ones, and each of these is one patient. So you don't need to be a biostatistician or a geneticist or anything to realize that this is very heterogeneous. You have, for example, in this patient, there may be a mutation in this gene, but the next patient has a mutation in a completely different gene, and sometimes they are completely different. So this is a little bit complicated for us, thinking about targeted therapies. The two main things that are consistent, if you think about this, in red you see the point mutations and in blue copy number changes. If you look at the ER-positive breast cancers and you look at the top, the most frequent mutation is the PI3 kinase mutation. It's the second line. You see a lot of red squares. In the ER-negative, mostly the triple-negative, you see most of them at the top have P53 mutations. It's very significant. So for the ER-negative, P53 is the most important driver in this population. Now, we don't know how to target P53. We've known about P53 for many years. It's one of the most important tumor suppressor genes in any type of cancer. It's mutated in about half of solid tumors. But for us, as you think about targeted therapies, how do you target a tumor suppressor gene? It's easier to target a oncogene, but very difficult to target a tumor suppressor gene. So in any case, but if you look at this, on the right side, in the ER negative, all of these patients, almost all of them except one, have the P53 mutations. Very important area. Yeah, and again, if you look at the ER positive, mostly PI3 kind. But the others is a complete random. You can have any kind of mutations. For example, these are three patients out of this figure that have 12 driver mutations in three breast cancers, and there is no overlap. So again, as we move into the future, how to develop targeted therapies for these patients is going to be a very big challenge. And I don't have the answer for you, but you know, we've been very successful with HER2, with the estrogen receptor to some degree, but there may be other things that are driving these tumors. And finding a specific treatment for each patient is going to be difficult, but is what we would like to do moving forward in the future. Now, here you see in the ER positives, a lot of patients have PI3 kinase mutations. 30% of the patients, a third of the patients have PI3 kinase mutations. What does that mean, though? I don't know how you do it here, but the way it's moving in the field is moving in the United States is that you can send your tumor to a laboratory and they sequence all these things and they give you the report and you see, oh, this patient has a PI3 kinase mutation. We have a PI3 kinase inhibitor. We're going to treat the patient and then we have a targeted therapy. Is that true? So this is a study from Spain presented at the ASCO meeting, the last ASCO meeting. And this is from the phase one group at the group in Barcelona, where they had patients treated with PI3 kinase and mTOR inhibitors, and they had the sequence of the PI3 kinase and P10 in many of these patients. So they looked at the response and the time to progression in these patients in the phase one setting who had these mutations. There were two groups of patients. One, they had the 20 patients had single agent therapy with PI3 kinase or mTOR inhibitors, and then another group of patients who received treatment in combination. And one of the problems, as you can see on this slide, is that the response to this treatment was very heterogeneous. So this is just the group of patients who had PI3 kinase mutations, or mTOR, or PI3 mutations, or P10 alterations, and this is the response to the targeted treatments. So the patient on top, for example, the first patient who did had the longest time to progression, the best response, this patient actually had no mutation. The second patient in blue had P10 loss, but the next patient didn't have the mutation, the next one had a PI3 kinase mutation. So the fact that you have a PI3 kinase mutation doesn't mean you're going to be cured with a PI3 kinase inhibitor. It's a little bit more complicated than that. And that's what, as we were discussing this morning, what you need to do the studies prospectively in this type of patients to see which ones are really the ones we need to treat. We don't have to treat every patient with every treatment, but we still don't know what is the right treatment for this population. So again, more work to do. At MD Anderson in Houston, we are doing several clinical trials. One of them, we are actually patients who have primary tumors who come to see us, even if they have more advanced disease. We try to look at the primary tumors, and then we are going to sequence a number of genes to see which ones are abnormal, and then we're going to establish a database of these patients for the future and see how they respond to these targeted therapies or to standard therapies. So initially, the patients, and this is a research project, it's not something we do in the routine clinical practice, but it's a research project. We are now testing the 47 genes, and then we're going to expand to 200 genes, and if we don't find any mutation, we're going to do the whole genome, but that's a very intensive work. We're also doing a study in the metastatic setting, where we're actually going to biopsy patients with metastases, in the liver or lung or chest wall or any metastasis. And we're going to do sequencing of many of these genes also to see if we can identify patients for different types of clinical trials. So this is what's ongoing at the moment. It's very difficult, very challenging to do. So we don't have any specific data yet, but this is what how we're thinking to move into the future. So in summary, I think it's very important to validate these prognostic and predictive markers in randomized clinical trials, if possible, if not in prospective, small, very focused, targeted clinical trials. We should incorporate tissue collection in clinical trials in the metastatic setting, in the neoadjuvant setting, to understand mechanisms of resistance and to find what are the best drugs for each patient. Another important area, as I showed you with the PET scans and so on, is to find non-invasive ways to monitor response to treatment, and we need to also follow these patients long-term to see what's the long-term toxicity, especially in the adjuvant setting where we're going to treat these patients for long periods of time. So the goal is to find more effective and less toxic treatment for our patients. Now, just to end, I think it's going to be very important to work together to have this team science approach where clinicians and surgeons and oncologists and pathologists, biologists, epidemiologists, biostatisticians all work together to actually solve this problem of tumor heterogeneity and targeted therapy. Thank you for your attention.
За очень интересную содержательную лекцию. Пожалуйста, если у аудитории есть вопросы, подходите к микрофону.
May I ask this question? Due to genomic and difference between the primary and metastatic lesions, do you perform routinely biopsy in a patient with metastatic disease before you make a clinical decision, or if you do not it routinely?
So we try to do that the first time the patient has metastatic disease, we try to do a biopsy of the metastatic tumor, and repeat some of the markers like HER2 or ER, PR if they were negative before. If they're positive before, it's a little more complicated because there's also heterogeneity in the metastases, and I don't think you can trust all the tests. But if the patient, for example, was triple negative, I think it's fair to see if you have these receptors, because it could be a testing issue or could be biology, but sometimes that's different. But it's very important to do a metastatic biopsy the first time. We do it to confirm that the patient has truly metastatic disease, but also we do some of these biomarkers. The other ones I was talking about is more on the research side, that we try to ask the patient's permission to do more genomics.
Thank you.
Да, пожалуйста.
Neosphere combined target therapy was less effective in hormone receptor positive disease.
Yes. So, the difference, when we look at the, even with the standard chemotherapy, the response in the estrogen receptor positive and the estrogen receptor negative is very different. So the estrogen receptor positive tumors tend to have less response, pathologic complete response to chemotherapy versus the ER negative, estrogen receptor negative breast cancer. But it is true that also in the HER2 targeted therapies with lapatinib and trastuzumab, they seem to be different based on the expression of the ER, the estrogen receptor. But it's also different among the different clinical trials. So I'm not sure we can use that to differentiate, what are the right population to treat with these combinations. For example, the study we did at MD Anderson a few years ago, combining Herceptin with chemotherapy in the neoadjuvant setting, we didn't see any difference in the ER positive, HER2 positive versus ER positive, HER2, I mean, there were HER2 positives, but ER positive, ER negative. So it is a mechanism of resistance in some ways, but I think it's more probably relevant to the endocrine therapies and not so much about the HER2 by itself.
So I'll combine endocrine therapy plus target therapy, right. Trastuzumab, for example. To chemotherapy, it's understandable. It's pathological complete response and more often in ER negative. But for target therapy,
right. The endocrine therapy seems to be less. Doing neoadjuvant endocrine therapies is always a little bit problematic because it takes so long. So we don't see a lot of this pathologic complete responses without chemotherapy. But combining the endocrine therapy with the targeted therapy is probably more effective.
It's a clinical study of Bella Kaufman from the United States. It's combined.
Yes. So I agree. Combining both is more effective. Yeah.
Спасибо. Еще вопрос. Если нет вопросов, давайте еще раз поблагодарим профессора Эстеву за его...